بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين، سيدي وحبيبي ونور قلبي، طب القلوب ودوائها، وعافية الأبدان وشفائها، ونور الأبصار وضيائها، أبي القاسم محمد. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين الذين أذهب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا. اللهم قال إمامنا الإمام أمير المؤمنين علي عليه السلام في دعاء المعروف: اللهم إني أسألك برحمتك التي وسعت كل شيء، وبقوتك التي قهرت بها كل شيء وخضع لها كل شيء وذل لها كل شيء، وصلى الله على محمد وآله الطاهرين. اللهم صل على Part of the lessons of Karbala that we're supposed to learn tonight is to share a light about the importance of Thursday night, and especially dua that we just read called dua Kumail. This dua, we read it every Thursday night, but it's important to learn some of the lessons that this dua contains. But before we proceed to the dua Kumail, let me share some light about the importance of Thursday night. What is the significance of the Thursday night? Why do we have to read dua Kumail on Thursday night? The first thing we have to understand, that a part of the custom of Allah, and Allah mentioned in the Quran, His custom, is that everything Allah creates, He goes back and choose the best out of it. Everything that He creates. From top to down. And I'll give you an example from the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, part of His creation is that He created angels. Angels, they are uncountable. Nobody knows the number of them. Nobody can tell you the number of the angels except Allah. Because they ask Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq alayhi salam, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad. How many? What are the numbers of the angels? I say, adaduhum ka'adadi turab. The way that you cannot count the sand, that's how you cannot count the angels. That's how many they are. But they are given different responsibilities. Out of all those angels, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala came and chose one, and it's called Angel Jibreel. That is the best of all. That is among the angels. Then you come among the humans. Allah also chose certain individuals, certain people. We call them prophets. Now, all those prophets also, they all are not the same level. Some of them are higher than the others. وَلَقَدْ فَضَّلْنَا بَعْضَ النَّبِيِّينَ عَلَى بَعْضٍ. They are all prophets, but some of them are higher than the others. Now you come among the messengers, also the same thing. They are all messengers, but they are not on the same level. And Allah mentioned the Quran in Surah Al-Baqarah, تِلْكَ الرُّسُلُ فَضَّلْنَا بَعْضَهُمْ عَلَى بَعْضٍ. Some of messengers are higher than the others. You come among our imams. We have 12 imams, but they are not on the same level too. Some are higher than the others. Example, you have Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen, and you have other imams as well. But the level of Imam Ali is higher than the rest of the Imams. And the Prophet says, Al Hasan wal Hussein Imaman, in qama aw qa'ada wa abuhuma khayrun minhuma. Imam Hassan and Hussein, they're Imams. But their father, Imam Ali, is much higher than them. That is among the Ahlul Bayt. So among the people, Allah chose some people are higher than the others. Now when you come among the days that Allah created, Allah also chose some days. They are better than the others. One of the chosen nights is the Thursday night. And why so? Why did Allah choose Thursday? Here comes the reason. Number one. One of the reasons why Thursday night is a special. Because every Thursday night is the night Allah tells the two angels, which is called Raqib and Atid. These two angels, their job is to write everything we do. Everything. Now, when they write, every week, they have to present the report to their master. Who's their master? The master is the Imam of the time. So every Thursday, these two angels, they take our report card and then they take it to the Imam. They say to Imam, this is the report card of your Ummah. And Imam goes through that report card. Anybody who does good, you put a smile on the face of Imam, especially on Thursday night. Those who have done wrong and they have sinned or disobeyed, then Imam becomes sad and then he makes dua for us. And how did we know this? Because in Bihar al-Anwar, there is hadith that is quoted from Imam al-Radha alayhi salam. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. A man came to Imam al-Radha and he says, Yabna Rasulillah, udu'u Allah li. Make dua for me. Then Imam responded, Awala af'al? Do you think I don't make dua for you? Then the man asked, Wakayf? How do you make dua for me? Then Imam says, Fawalladhi ba'atha Muhammadan bilhaq. I swear by the Lord who sent Prophet Muhammad with the truth. Anna a'malakum tu'radu alayna. Our deeds, your deeds, Imam was telling him, your deeds is always presented to us. When? It's a ashiyata qiyawm al-khamis. Every Thursday night, they bring the report cards. Then Imam looks in the report cards. Who did what? Who didn't do what? He said, فَمَا كَانَ مِنْ خَيْرٍ. Whatever is a good deed that has been done, he says, شَكَرْنَا وَحَمَدْنَا اللَّهِ. Then we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for those good deeds. وَمَا كَانَ مِنْهَا. Whatever happens of the bad deeds, he says, استغفرنا لكم. Then we ask Allah istighfar. Then Imam Radha read the ayah where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَا كَانَ اللَّهُ مُعَذِّبَهُمْ وَأَنْتَ فِيهِمْ وَمَا كَانَ اللَّهُ مُعَذِّبَهُمْ وَهُمْ يَسْتَغْفِرُونَ. That is one of the importance of the night of Thursday. Because it's the night Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered the angels to take our a'mal and present it to the Imam. And that is why we have to observe tonight with dua, because you don't want your book to be presented to Imam and you or me are in the wrong place. That is one of the reasons why tonight is important. Number two, one of the reasons why tonight is important in Alam al-Barzakh, those who already passed and they're in Alam al-Barzakh, every Thursday night, Allah releases all the souls to go anywhere they want to go. From Monday, Tuesday, Thursday, Wednesday, they are all locked up. They are not allowed to go anywhere. Those who are in the punishment of Allah, they stay there. Those who are in the rahmah of Allah, they stay there. But on Thursday evening, Allah release all of them to go anywhere they want to go. And where do they go, by the way? Those arwah, those people in the barzakh, where do they go? Those arwah, those souls, they come to the house of their families. The house of their families. What do they do when they come? Huh. When they come and they are asking from their families, relatives, to do something for them. What do they say? Now this is the narration says, when they come, they call. Ya awladi. If it's a dad and enough the children, then he calls, oh my children. Then he calls them names, by names, one by one. And then he said, tasaddaqu anna mimma razaqakum Allah. Give sadaqah from whatever Allah has blessed you with. And by the way, you know, in Alam al-Barzakh, those who pass, the best gift you can give them is sadaqah. Any good deed is good, but the best of all is sadaqah. And let me draw your attention to one important message. Mostly in our communities, the night of burial, which we call Laylatul Wahsha, we have something we call Salatul Wahsha. We perform two rakah prayer for the soul of the marhum. One of the things we missing is we take one part of the hadith and forget the other part of the hadith. Because when you go back to the hadith, this is the actually complete part of the hadith. The hadith said, the night of burial, if you cannot afford sadaqah, then do salat al-wahsha. The first part is sadaqah. The hadith says, first give sadaqah. If you cannot afford sadaqah, then the second option is salat al-wahsha. But what do? We just do the salat al-wahsha and forget the sadaqah. The sadaqah is more important than the salat al-wahsha itself. But if a person can combine both, that is even better. But the most important is sadaqah for the soul of the marhum. When you give that sadaqah, it makes and puts the happiness in the soul of that marhum. But whatever the case is, those marhumin, when they come to the houses of their family and they ask them, tasaddaqu, give sadaqah on Thursday night. And sadaqah can be anything. It can be food. It can be money. It can be two rakatain, sadaqah for the marhum. That is why this night is very important. That is number two. Number three. The night of Thursday also is the night that is important because it's the night our 12th Imam encouraged his followers to think and start preparing for his arrival on Friday. Because Imam, when he appears on Friday. Now, Thursday night is the beginning of Friday. So the followers of Imam, they are encouraged to think, to spend the night of Thursday night thinking about 12th Imam. In the same line, if your wife is coming out of town, she's coming the next day, what do? They're preparing the house, making sure everything is clean, everything is prepared by the time she arrives. The same thing applies to her husband. If the husband is out of the country and he's coming and you know he's coming tomorrow, then what happened? The wife started to make sure that everything is taken care of, everything is organized. Now the same thing applies to the followers of Imam. The night before his arrival, which is Friday, it is important to spend the night thinking about this Imam. That is why Thursday night is important. That is number three. Number four, the night of Thursday is also important because our imams have encouraged their followers not to let the night of Thursday to go unless they read dua we call Allahu Akbar, Ziyarat Warith. Allahu Akbar. Ziyarat Warith, yes. You know why? Inshallah, someday when Allah give us a chance, we will talk about this ziyarah, which is called ziyarah warith. When you talk about Imam Hussein alayhi salam in that dua, and then you say, ya waritha Adam safwatillah, ya waritha Nuhin nabiyillah, and then you go down to all the prophet, he inherited everything. Now the question, what did he inherit from Adam? What did he inherit from Isa alayhi salam? What did he inherit from Noah? All of this dua is very important to read in the night of Thursday. And this is for the Shia of Imam Hussein alayhi salam. Number five, one of the recommendations of doing tonight is to read dua we call dua kumail. Fama adraka ma dua kumail. This dua and some narration is called dua khidr. Some narrations. They call dua Khidr. Because Khidr used to read this dua too. This dua is so powerful to the point where it's highly recommended at least to read it once in your lifetime. At least once in a lifetime. If you cannot read it, right, every time, the least is recommended is to read it once in a lifetime. If you can read more, they say at least once in a month. If you can do it more, they say it's recommended to read it every Thursday night. Now, what is the good thing about this dua? The narration said, if a person reads this dua, there are so many things Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is grant. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to give him. Number one, dua kumail, what it does, they said, yadfa'u sharrul a'da. It protects the reader from anything the enemies are plotting against you. Do you have enemies? You want Allah to protect you? One of the way to be protected is to read dua kumail. Because when you read dua kumail, there's part of it that we read. Waqfini sharral injinni wal insi min a'da'i. Ya Allah, protect me from the evil of my enemies, whether they are humans or jinn, all of them together. That is part of the dua. There are others also, you say, in the dua. One of the benefits of this dua is it protects you from your enemies. That is one. Number two, one of the blessings of this dua, they say, وَتَفْتَحُ أَبْوَابَ الرِّزْقِ. People who have difficulty of finding a job, risk, dua kumail is the answer. Dua kumail is one of the answers. A person who reads this dua, but when we say reading, there are two kinds of reading, by the way. There is one reading, I'm reading for the sake of reading, and the one that I read also with understanding and knowing who I'm talking to and what am I saying to him, that is the dua that we're talking about. That reading, it also opens the door of risk. And this is one of the things about the dua kumail. The third thing about this dua, they said, a person who read dua kumail, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also will make sure that that person will die in the path of Islam. If you're concerned about your end, your life, your future, dua kumail is the answer. That is the importance of this dua. Now let's come to the dua and see what is the dua is all about. What did Imam say about it? Now this dua, Imam Ali alayhi salam used to read it every Thursday night. But he never taught anybody. One day, Kumail ibn Ziyad and Nakhai, one of the greatest companions of Imam, he came to Imam's house to visit. And he heard Imam was reading the dua. He stopped at the entrance of the house and he was listening. Then, after Imam finished, he knocked the door. Imam had him inside. He sat with Imam. Then he said to Imam Ali, I came earlier and I heard the dua you were reading, and the dua is so beautiful. Can you please teach me the dua? Then Imam said to him, Ya Kumail, take a paper and pen. He took paper and pen, and Imam started reading, and he was writing. And he wrote the entire dua. Now Kumail, when he left there, he went and started reading the dua and started teaching the others, and the dua became dua o Kumail instead of dua o Amir al-Mu'mineen. Because the actual one who taught him was Imam Ali. But the dua was known today, dua o Kumail, because Kumail is the one who publicized the dua. Because Imam Ali was reading just by himself. Now check the dua, the first part of the dua. What did Imam Ali say? Allahumma inni as'aluka bi rahmatika allati wasi'at kulla shay. I'm just going to talk about just this part. The first part he says, Allahumma. What is the meaning of the word Allahumma? Allahumma is actually two words merged to become one. In Arabic, the word Ya Allah, yeah, is the call for Allah. Oh Allah. If you want to make it one word, then you say Allahumma. So the word Allahumma is a call that we call Ya Allah. If you don't want to make it two words, then you merge them and you make them Allahumma. Allahumma means Oh Allah. And you know what Ya Allah means? You know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has 99 attributes. 99. But out of the 99, Allah has favorite names. Favorites. And you know, by the way, brothers, this is just take home message. You know the names of Allah, they are like what? They are like medicines. When you walk into the pharmacies, there are so many medicines. Each one of them is a medication. But when you go there, you don't pick anyone just because it's there. You go there and pick up the one that you need and you buy them. The names of Allah are the same thing. You gotta know what you want from Allah and call him by that name. When you go to call Allah, you cannot just use any name and call Allah just because it's the name of Allah. You gotta know what I want from Allah, then I call Allah with that name. For example, I want knowledge from Allah. What should I call? I call him Ya Alim because it's from the word the ilm. Now, if you want ilm and you call Ya Wadud, you're doing the wrong thing, brother. You go to Allah. You want to be the wealthiest person on the planet. What should you call Allah to make that happen? Ya Ghani, because Allah is the most richest one. So he said Ya Ghani. You go to Allah, you want people to love you anywhere you go. What should you call Allah? So Allah provide that for you. You say, Ya Wadud. I am so angry all the time. I want to be patient. I don't know what to do. Now the name to call for Allah to give you patience, Ya Sabur. Every name of Allah is for specific medication. You gotta know what you need and what you're asking Allah for, right? But here comes the thing. But then Allah knows not everybody knows how to call upon him, right? Then he chose two out of the 99 to be his favorite. The first one, the first favorite name of Allah is the word Rabb. Rabb is the favorite name of Allah. The second one is the word Allah. Now you go to the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, most of the names that he has been called by the Prophet are the word Ya Rabb. Now let's go to Adam. Adam alayhi salam, when he surrounded Allah by eating the tree from the in the heaven, and when he came out, now he wants to call Allah. Ya Allah, I want your forgiveness. Look, what did he call Allah? He said, Rabbi inni zalamtu. Rabbana inna zalamna anfusana. Rabbana zalamna. Oh Allah, we have wronged ourselves. But the name is just Rabbana. Nuh alayhi salam, when he wanted Allah to help him with his people, when he got to the point that they don't listen, he said, Rabbi inni maglubun fantasr. That's Nuh alayhi salam. Ibrahim al-Khalil in the Quran, when he wants to call Allah after he finished the house and everything, even before when he went to Mecca to find the actual Kaaba, he says, Rabbi inni askantu dhurriyati biwad. The word Rabb is what you call Allah. Prophet Isa alayhi salam, when the disciple asked him to ask Allah to send the food from the sky, what did he say? In the Quran, Allahumma Rabbana anzil alayna ma'idatan min as-sama. Our Prophet also, Allah taught him, Ya Rasulullah, you want knowledge? Yes. How should I ask? He said, Waqul Rabbi zidni ilma. Our Imam Ali alayhi salam, go to him. Whenever he calls Allah, he said, Ya Rab, dua kumil yurid. Right? He calls Allah with different names. Ya Sayyidi, wa Mawlai, wa Malik Raqi. Huh? And all of the names, he always mentioned them one time. But when he get to Ya Rab, how many times did he call? Three times. Ya Rabbi, Ya Rabbi, Ya Rab. Why? Because that is one of the favorite names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Imam Ali himself, when he go to Hadith al-Kisa, right? When he talked and he asked Imam the Prophet, Ya Rab, Ma li julusina min al-fadl inda Allah. What did the answer came? Ya walladhi ba'athani bil haqqi nabiyyan ma dhukira khabaruna fi mahfilin min mahafil ahli al-ard wa fi jam'un min shi'atina wa muhibbina illa wa nazalat alayhim ar-rahma wa haffat bihim al-mala'ika wa astaghfarat lahum ila an yatafarraqu. Right? Now listen to the answer of Imam Ali. Idhan fuzna wa faza shi'atuna wa rabbil Ka'bah. That's Imam Ali. ورب الكعبة. He doesn't say والله الكعبة. No, ورب الكعبة. Right? The same Imam Ali, when he was in the Salat and he got struck, what did he call Allah? He said, فزت ورب الكعبة. What does he call Rab? What does he call other names? Because they knew that one of the favorite names of Allah is Rab. That is one favorite name of Allah. Another one is the word Allah. The word Allah is called Kalimatun Ismul A'zam. The greatest name of Allah. And this is the favorite, my favorite, that's the favorite name. It's amazing. Just the word Allah, right? Now look at it. It's five letters. Alif, Lam, and Lam, and Lam, and then Ha. But then they merged one Lam into another Lam and became one. Right? So it became Alif and Lam and Lam and Ha. That's why you see the Shadda that's written on top, is indicated by two and they were merged together. Look at the word Allah. Alif, Lam and Lam and Ha. That is the name of Allah. You take the Alif out, it's still the name of Allah. How do you read it? Lillahi ma fi samawati wa ma fil ard. Good. The Alif drop, but it's still for Allah. Drop the another lamb also. Take alif and lamb. Now you have lamb and ha. What does it become? Lahu ma fi samawati wa ma fi al-ard. Drop the last lamb also and leave the ha. The ha also represents Allah. Allahu la ilaha illa hu. Who is the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Every word, every letter of Allah, it represents Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is why it's called Ismul A'zam, the greatest attribute of Allah. Anytime you want to call Allah with a name that you want Allah to respond, call him Allah. And that is why this name, Allah said, you cannot give to anybody. Because the names of Allah are two kinds. Some names you are allowed to give to some people, some names you cannot. And that is why Imam Ali and Dua Kumail, when he called Allah, he knows the favorite name. He said, Allahumma. He calls him by his favorite name, which is the word Allah. That's Dua Kumail. Then he comes to the next word, Inni. Inni means what? Indeed, I. Allahu Akbar. What does it mean, Inni? In Arabic, when you say the word Inna, it's called Harfut Tawkeed. Or adat at-ta'kid. At-ta'kid means emphasis. You emphasize on something. Imam Ali alayhi salam is emphasizing to Allah. Allahumma inni, Allah, indeed I your servant. Why is he emphasizing to Allah? Because there are two people who call Allah. Some people call Allah and they're very serious in their call. Some people, they call Allah and they are play, they are not serious. Imam Ali wants to tell you in Dua Kumail, Ya Allah, my call, a serious call. Allahumma inni, indeed, I. What do I do? As'aluk. I'm asking you, Allah. Now here comes another part of the lesson we can learn from just Dua Kumail. In Arabic, when you say the word as-su'al, it has different branches. Just the word su'al. The word as-su'al means one of the meaning to ask someone. Asking someone has different categories. Number one, sometimes I ask someone something because I don't know. That knowledge, Islam encouraged this. And Allah said in the Quran, Fas'alu ahla dhikri in kuntum la ta'lamu. Islam encourages, if you don't know something, ask, learn. Educate yourself. Don't be shy. La haya fi din. That is one. Number two, there is another question also. Sometimes you ask question Not because you don't know. You know, but you ask anyway. Why do you ask? You ask because you want the other audience to learn from that question. Imam Ali does that a lot. Imam Ali and the gathering, he asks the Prophet, Ya Rasulullah, tell me, what is this? He knows, but he asks not because of him, because of the audience. Giving you an example, before the month of Ramadan, the Prophet was talking about the month of Ramadan. Then Imam Ali said, Ya Rasulullah, ma huwa afdalul a'mal fi hadha shahr. Tell me, what is the best deed to do in the month of Ramadan? Imam Ali didn't know. Of course, you know. But why is he asking? For the other audience to learn from that. Then the Prophet answered, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, afdalul a'mal fi hadha shahr al-wara'u an maharimillah. The best deed in the month of Ramadan is to stay away from sin. That is also another question. Another question. It's not a question because you want to learn or you want others to learn. No, no. Sometimes some people ask so they can test the water. And they do this to Maulanas a lot. Right? See, Maulana, I want to know how much he knows. Right? So what do? Let me ask him a question if he knows. Right? Sometimes some people tell, oh, I asked this question before, but I want to hear your answer. If you know or not, it's normal, it happens. This question is not for knowledge, it's for curiosity, right? So sometimes you ask someone, not because you want to know, it's what you want to know how much he knows. That's the third question. The fourth one, sometimes you ask a question because you want the person you're asking to prove them they don't know anything. You know what it's called in Arabic? Su'al ta'jizi. Su'al, question, to prove the person he doesn't know enough. How? I'll give you an example. Our Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq alayhi salam. He did with one of his students, Abu Hanifa. When Abu Hanifa came, and he was big in Iraq. Everybody looks upon him as a scholar, great scholar. Imam Ali wants to tell, Imam Ja'far wants to show him, no, you're not a scholar. Yeah, you can be scholar in Iraq, but when you come to us, you're a student. Okay? When he came, Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq saw him. He said, Ya Abu Hanifa, I heard you are a scholar in Iraq. He said, yes, I am. Can I ask you a question? He said, sure, go ahead. Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq said, okay, tell me. What's the difference between a salat and fasting? Which one is more important? You're a scholar, right? I'm going to prove to me. Salat and fasting. Which one is important? Then Abu Hanifa said, salat is more important. Then Imam said, okay. If what you say is true, then why if a woman misses salat in the month, then she doesn't have to pay it, but if she missed the fasting and the month of Ramadan, she has to pay it later. If salat is important, shouldn't she pay the salat and leave the fasting? Then Abu Hanifa said, no, yeah, that's right, you're right. You're right. Bunch of questions, Imam asked him, after the whole question and answer session, Abu Hanifa realized that, no, I don't know anything. Then he asked Imam, can I be your student? Imam said, come in. 2 years, he studied under Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq. And he says, لَوْلَا السَّنَتَان لَهَلَكَ النُّعْمَانِ. If not because of these 2 years, I was student of Imam, he said, I would have perished. That question is called, سُؤَال تَعْجِيزِ. You ask to prove the person that he doesn't know. Another question. Sometimes you ask a question, not because you don't know, you know, but you want the person you're asking to talk. It's called as-su'al lil-habib. Question for somebody you love. You want them to talk to you, so you post them a question, even though you know that question. You know the answer. Example, you go to the Quran. Allah does do this to Musa a lot. Allah says Musa alayhi salam with a stick. Then he said to him, وَمَا تِلْكَ بِيَمِينِكَ يَا مُوسَى. What is in your right hand? Allah doesn't see. Of course he knows. Musa also, he got it. Right? So look at his answer. He said, Ya Rab. He said, Hiya asaya. That's my stick. But it doesn't stop there. Ahushu biha ala ghanami. Waliya fiha ma'aribun ukhra. Then he keep going. Ya Allah. Ya Allah.
about one question, but he goes to talk to Allah. Ya Allah, it's my steak. I use it to also run my animals, and also I use it also to lean on it, and also I do with it also other. Then he keep going on and on and on, because he knew the question that Allah asked is Allah loved to talk to him, and that is what's called Kalimullah. That is one of the questions. Another question, which is the best of all, is the question a servant posed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When you ask Allah, Ya Allah, I want this. Allah loves this more than anything else. And that's what Imam Ali said in Dua Kumail, Allahumma inni as'aluk, oh Allah, I am your servant, I am your slave, I'm here to ask nobody but you, because you are the one who deserves to be asked. But when I ask Allah, what do I ask him with? Bi rahmatika allati wasi'at kulla shay. I ask you, not because of me, because I'm not worthy of a person to stand in front of you to ask you. But I know you have something called rahmah, a mercy. That mercy reaches to every creature. And you know, in the hadith they said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created 100 pieces of mercy. 100 he created. Then he took one out of the 100. Then he divided it into another 100. Then he took one out of that 100. Then he divided that pieces among every creatures that he ever created. The rahmah, the mercy that you see among humans is from that piece of just one. The rahmah of Allah that you see among the animals, when you see a mother, the way they treat their children, whether it's a lion, whether it's a chicken, any animal that you see, the way they have mercy upon their children and their friends, all came from that one rahmah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Not only that, they say the rahmah that Allah has for us, Ya Allah, if we are to understand, we will not go anywhere but to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The rahmah of Allah, brothers, is so much to even talk about. Number one, look at the rahmah of Allah. Prophet Musa alayhi salam, one time he was talking to Allah. Ya Rab, I have a question for you. Allah said, go ahead, Ya Musa. What is your question? He said, Ya Allah, if you have three people, one of them is a servant that obeys your teaching. Then he calls you, Ya Allah, what do you do? Allah said, Ya Musa, aqulu lahu labbaik. I tell you, yes, my servant, what do you want? Then Musa said, Ya Allah, what do you say to a servant of yours who is in the sujood and he calls your name? Allah said, aqulu lahu labbaik, atalu labbaik. Then Musa said, Ya Allah, my third question. What do you say to your servant who is committing sin and then remember and called you? What do you say? You know what the answer came from Allah? He said, Ya Musa, aqulu lahu labbaika, 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 three times. The rahmah of Allah. The rahmah of Allah is so big, more than we can imagine. In Surah At-Tawbah, there was a man who came to the Prophet. Ya Rasulullah, I've committed a sin. And I don't think Allah is going to forgive me. He was crying so bad. The Prophet said, oh, Allah will forgive you. Don't worry about it. He said, Ya Rasulullah, no way. Allah is going to forgive me. Then the Prophet said to him, Ya Abdullah, your sin, is it bigger? Is your sin bigger compared to the mountain of Uhud? Or Uhud is bigger than your sin? He said, Ya Rasulullah, my sin is so bigger than even the mountain of Uhud. Then the Prophet says, even with that, Allah will forgive. He said, no, Ya Rasulullah. Then the Prophet said to him, Ya Abdullah, your sin, is it bigger? Or the entire Mecca and Medina is bigger? He said, Ya Rasulullah, my sin is bigger than Mecca and Medina. The Prophet said, Allah will forgive you, don't worry. He said, La, Ya Rasul, I don't think so. The Prophet said, Ya Abdullah, Adhambuka A'azam Amis Samawati A'azam.
Your sin is bigger, or the heavens, all the seven heavens are bigger than your sin.
I say, Ya Rasulullah, Adhambi A'azam Min As-Samawat. The Prophet said, Inshallah, Allah will forgive you. Then the Prophet said, Ya Abdullah, Adhambuka A'azam Amil Ard A'azam. Say, Ya Rab, Ya Rasulullah, my sin is bigger than the entire earth. Then the Prophet asked him another question.
Ya Abdullah, adhanbuka a'azam am as-samawati wal-ard jami'an a'azam.
Is your sin bigger compared to the heavens and the earth
and combined?
Or no, your sin is bigger than both. Say, Ya Rasulullah, my sin is bigger than both. Can you imagine what kind of sin this man did?
That he cannot even see that the Prophet is asking him these questions.
I say, Ya Rasulullah, I don't think Allah will forgive me. Then the last question the Prophet asked him, say, Ya Abdullah, adhanbuka a'azam amillah a'azam.
Is your sin bigger or Allah is bigger than your sin?
That was the bottom. He says, Allah a'azam min dhanbi. He said, Allah will forgive you. Then he said, well, kayf? Immediately Allah sent Jibreel, Ya Rasulullah, tell him that whatever sin he committed is nothing to Allah, but him being hopeless from the mercy of Allah is worse than the sin that he committed.
Him being hopeless, he thinks Allah will not forgive him. He says Allah doesn't even, that hope being hopeless is worse than the sin that he committed.
And then the Prophet told him, he said, Allah told me in Hadith al-Qudsi, he said, Allah said, I created you people, and I created you in a way, you commit sin, and you ask for forgiveness, and that is why I call myself Al-Ghafoor al-Rahim.
Because if you are not committing sin and asking for forgiveness, then there is no point for me to call myself Ghafoor al-Rahim. Now, Imam Ali alayhi salam, he goes to Allah, he says, Allahumma inni as'aluka bi rahmatika allati wasi'at.
Because the rahmah of Allah have reached to everyone, including the Prophet. You know, one time the Prophet was asked, Ya Rasulullah, can I ask Allah to put me heaven because of my deeds? Then the Prophet said, no.
So why not? I pray, I fast, I go to Hajj, I do every good things.
The Prophet says, no one can enter heaven because of their deeds. Then the man asked, what about you, Ya Rasulullah?
Okay, me, I understand, but you, what about you?
Then the Prophet said, even myself, I'm not gonna enter heaven because of my deeds. Then the man asked, Ya Rasulullah, what is it that's gonna qualify us to enter heaven? Then the Prophet says, مَا دَخَلَ ابْنُ آدَمِ الْجَنَّةَ إِلَّا بِرَحْمَتِهِ. Everyone gets to go to heaven because of the rahmah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Imam Ali alayhi salam, that is why Imam Zayn al-Abidin in dua, he says, when you ask Allah this. He says, Allahumma la tu'amilna bi'adlik, walakin amilna bi'rahmatik.
Ya Allah, when you deal with us, don't deal with us with your justice, because none of us can stand the justice of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
What should Allah deal with us? He said, Allahumma amilna bi rahmatik.
Ya Allah, deal with us with your rahmah.
That is the part of the dua kubil. Just a drop out of the ocean of dua kubil. Allahumma inni as'aluka bi rahmatika allati wasi'at kulla shay.
Now look at this rahmah. Rahmah that we're talking about, that Allah created.
That rahmah between a master and the follower.
And that master is Imam Hussein alayhi salam. And who is that follower? Habib ibn Mudahir al-Asadi. This Habib was amazing. If you want to see the
sign of rahmah and mercy and love and obedience, look at Habib ibn Mudahir.
You know, Habib, he was way older than Imam Hussein.
Sometimes say he was in his 20s.
When Imam was in his 5-6 years old. But he was in love with Imam Hussein so much.
So much! It got to the point, anytime Habib sees Imam Hussein alayhi salam,
he will stop and drop everything. And you know what he does? Two things.
One,
he will just sit down, just staring at Imam Hussein.
If he doesn't do that, when he does the second thing, he follows Imam Hussein and he takes his footprint and he wipes on his face out of the love and the compassionate for Imam Hussein alayhi salam. One day his father called Mudahir. He saw him. Say, "Ya Habib, what are you doing?" Say, "Wallah, I love him." "You love him?"
Say, "Yes, I love him."
"You love Imam Hussein?"
Say, "Yes."
Then his father asked him, "Ya Habib, what would you like me to do for you and bring Imam Hussein close to you?"
Habib stood up and he was thinking. He said, "Can you invite them to my house, to our house? Is that what you want? Imam Hussein to come to your house? That's what you want?" He said, "Yes." Okay. Then his father Mudahir said, "I will tell Imam Ali. I will invite them, Imam Ali and his children, to come to the house." Habib was waiting.
His father Mudahir, he went, because he was one of the companions of Imam Ali.
He went and told Imam Ali, "Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, I have a small gathering in my house and I want to invite you. And I want you to come with Imam Hassan and Hussein. What do you think?" Imam Ali said, "Okay, sure, I will come. Invite me, I'll come."
He said, "I want you to bring Imam Hassan and Hussein with you."
I said, "I'll bring them. Don't worry about it." Okay. He set up a date and time. Habib, from that day his father came and told him the date, Habib wouldn't sleep.
Waiting for that day, that moment that he will unite with his Imam under one roof in one place where they can sit together and talk.
The day came. Habib will go on top of the roof, looking at the road when Imam Hassan and Hussein is coming. And he will run back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. And I want to tell you this, so when you read the ziyarah of Habib, you pay attention careful.
He goes on the roof and then he was looking. He doesn't see Imam Ali, Imam Ali and his children. Then he comes back, he comes down. Then he goes back again.
This time he goes up, then Imam Ali and Hassan and Hussein are coming. The moment he saw the nur of this Ahlul Bayt, he started shaking. Guess what happened? Habib fell
from the roof
to the ground. What happened to him? He died. Habib died?
Yes, he did. Allahu Akbar. Imam Ali walks in the house. Imam Hassan walks in the house.
The father was accepting them. Ahlan wa sahlan, welcome. They sat down. Imam Ali asked, "Where's Habib? Who wanted to see Hassan and Hussein?" Mudahir said, "He is coming, inshallah." They didn't know how to tell Imam Ali.
Imam Ali asked after a few minutes, "Where's Habib?"
Say, "Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, Habib is no longer alive." Say, "What happened?" Say, "Habib fell from the roof when he saw you coming and died." Imam Ali said, "Can I see him?" Say, "Sure." They went there, Imam Hassan, Imam Hussein, Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen. They saw Habib was laying down, deceased. Imam Ali looked at Imam Hussein. "Ya Hussein, you know this man died because of you. What do you want to do for him?" Then Hussein said, "What should I do?" Imam Hussein asked this question when he was crying. Then Imam Ali said, "Ask Allah to bring him back." And now, when we were talking about Ziyarat Warith, pay attention careful. When you say about Imam Hussein, "Assalamu alayka ya waritha Isa ruhillah." What did Isa used to do? Bring back the dead to life, right? That's what he does. Quran says.
Now he says, Imam Hussein inherited that. Where is that? Where is that? It's proven history.
Now here, Habib al-Mudahir. Then Imam Hussein alayhi salam raised his hand. And then he read this ziyarat warith. Allahumma inni warithu nabiyyaka Isa ibn Maryam.
Ya Allah, I inherited your servant Ibrahim, Isa alayhi salam. وَكَدْ أَعْطَيْتَهُ. And you're giving him the power of bringing the dead back to life. Allahumma, oh Allah,
bring this servant of yours back to life again. They're standing there. His father Mudahir was there. Imam Hassan was there. Imam Ali was there. Immediately, Habib ibn Mudahir opened his eyes and came back to life again.
This that I just mentioned, when you read his ziyara, it's mentioned in there. الَّذِي أَمَاتَهُ اللَّهُ مَوْتَتَيْنِ وَأَحْيَاهُ حَيَاتَيْنِ.
The one that Allah gave him two lives and two death. And both lives and death were spent for the sake of Ahlul Bayt alayhi wa sallam. This Habib ibn Mudahir, on the day of Ashura, he was 75 years old, very old, very aged. He came to Imam Hussein alayhi salam. And he said, Ibn Rasulillah, I want to go to the battlefield. He went to the battlefield, Allahu Akbar.
And the first thing he says, Ana Habib ibn Mudahir, I am Habib, son of Mudahir. He said, I am old man, but my sword is very strong. I'm here to defend the Imam of my time. I'm here to defend the religion of Allah. He goes to the battlefield, he starts fighting. The narration said, Habib, as old as he was able to kill more than 60 people of those enemies of Allah. Until one of them came behind Habib with his spear. And then he threw the spear at Habib. Habib ibn Mudahir fell on the ground. He took the spear out, trying to stand up again and chase the enemy to strike him. Another one came, and his name is Al-Hasin, la'natullahi alayh. While Habib was trying to stand up and go and fight and defend, this Hasin struck Habib on the head for the second time. Habib ibn Mudahir fell on the ground. Habib was first bleeding. Still, he was struggling to stand and go and fight. The narration said Habib could not because of the blood he lost. Habib was in that moment, the narration said. Then Burair came to him. He said, Ya Habib ibn Mudahir, what do you want at this time of the last moment of your life? What can I do for you? Habib looked at him and he says, Ya Burair, all I want from you is to take care of this gharib. And he was pointing to Imam Hussein alayhi salam. He said, I have no wish, I have nothing to ask you to do for me. But all I want you to do, Ya Burair, is to take care of Hussein, the stranger that was brought to Kufa, the stranger that was brought to Karbala. He said, I want you to take care of him. That's all I want. That's all my wish. Then Burair looked at him and said, Ya Habib, wallahi, I swear by Allah that I'll take good care of him. I promise that I will be killed for this great Imam, Imam Hussein alayhi salam. The narration said, Habib ibn Mudahir, what is in this situation? Burair was looking at him, فَإِذَا فَاضَتْ رُوحَا. Habib died in that situation. Imam Hussein rushed to him and he says, Ya Habib, assalamu alayka, Ya Habib. I say, oh, peace be upon you, Ya Habib. وَجَزَاكَ اللَّهُ أَنْ عَلِمُ Muhammadin khaira. May Allah reward you for all the good deeds that you have done for Ahlul Bayt, for Muhammad and his family. And then he said about Habib, wallahi kana yusalli bil layl. He said, I bear witness for Habib that he always prays salat al layl. Wa kana yakhtim al Quran fi kulli layla. And he used to also finish the whole Quran every night. Allahu Akbar. And then Imam Hussein made dua for him. They said, fa sharaka Allahu ma Jaddi. May Allah unite you with my grandfather, wa abi Amir al-Mu'mineen, and may Allah unite you with my father, Imam Ali as well. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un, wa sayalamu alladhina zalamu ayyamun qalabin yanqalibun, wal aqibatu lil muttaqeen. Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein.